Russia with arms but has been accused of selling it electronic and other components that can have a military use. BBC News.
Hello there, this is the news report on the BBC World Service. I'm Nick Miles. Many people have adopted children from China.
Turn right onto Pennsylvania 45 West, Old Turnpike Road.
Taking them on to at least 150,000 children have gone abroad this way in the last 3 decades. But now the Chinese government has had a rethink.
Continue on Pennsylvania 45 West for 3 miles.
A foreign ministry spokesperson saying the practice of allowing children to be adopted overseas is coming to an end. She said this via what she called the spirit of relevant international conventions. And she went on to express gratitude to foreign governments and families who wished to adopt Chinese children. Let's go from our Asia Pacific editor, Nikki Bristow. Nikki, what's been said about what might be the reasons behind this decision?
Turn left onto Dreisbach Church Road.
17 boys on Thursday night. He says an investigation into what caused it is now going to take place. The flames spread through a dormitory at Hillside and Barasha Primary School in the county of Miami, leaving over 100 other children.
Take the next left onto Dreisbach Church Road.
By our senior Africa correspondent, Anne Solly. Extraordinary, horrific pictures coming up from this. What do we know so far?
Continue for 5 miles.
The Ministry of Education has published the numbers of learners in that school, so it had a population of 824. However, just over 300 were boarding. 156 boys who were in that ill-fated dormitory, as the vast majority were rescued. However, 17 have been confirmed dead now. According to the police, they said many of the bodies were
recall in terms of the safety equipment there. What do we know about the general level of safety in schools like these?
It has been problematic, and partly because of schools trying to balance security and trying to prevent students from sneaking out. And the vast majority of buildings, not just schools, but even residential buildings in Kenya, have very strong metal bars on the windows, which, you know, do not enable people to escape quickly in case of an emergency. And that is really a security feature, but when there are emergencies like this, then it becomes a problem. The government did publish a set of guidelines on ensuring safety in schools, and so we've been waiting to hear whether this particular school had implemented those guidelines.
Thanks, Anne. I'm sorry there in Nairobi. Sextortion is a rapidly growing cybercrime. People are targeted by scammers pretending to be someone else who's romantically interested in them. Then they're trying to get the victim to send explicit images of themselves, and if they do, they extort money from them. Now, the US has just had its first successful prosecution of two men from Nigeria, where the crime is particularly prevalent. The brothers have been sentenced to 17.5 years in prison for a scam that led to an American teenager called Jordan DeMay to kill himself. Our cyber correspondent Joe Tyler told Catherine Gorahanga what happened.
He was befriended on Instagram by an attractive girl his age, he thought, called Danny, and they started talking and she was flirting with him, and then she sort of sent some sexual images and coaxed him into sending some intimate pictures of himself, and then that's when the two brothers came clean and said, actually, we are not who you think we are. We are scammers from Nigeria and we want you to pay us. And over the course of the next few hours, they managed to get Jordan to send them hundreds of dollars. It's all he had. He worked at McDonald's and that was sort of all his savings. And then when he said, I can't send you any more, please don't share the pictures with anybody, don't send them around to my friends and family like they were threatening, he said, if you do this, I will kill myself. And then the message records show that the Nigerians said, good, do that, or we'll make you do it. And then, of course, we know that he did take his life that night, and it was in 2022, and it's taken a long time for the police and obviously the family who've been going through this whole thing to see justice.
And Joe, let's play listeners a bit of this interview. This is what Jordan DeMay's mother had to say about the outcome of this legal case.
It's a relief that someone is being held accountable, but at the end of the day, it doesn't change that Jordan's not here. It's really a struggle because there's no good that is coming out of this situation for my family or for the individual's responsible's family. The best thing that can come of this is that it's setting an example for the people who are doing this to other individuals, that you can be caught. It's not a nameless crime, and hopefully that deters them from continuing to go after our children. And it's also creating awareness for kids that this is what's going on. It's continuing to rise, and they need to be aware of who they are talking to on social media.
Yes, Jordan DeMay's mother there. And Joe, how significant has this legal trial been?
It's been hugely significant because, of course, the Jordan DeMay story, partly thanks to the woman you heard, Jane Butte's mother, has been very, very high profile. She has become something of a campaigner on TikTok, for example, telling young people about what happened to her son. She's done every single news outlet in the US and been trying to push the awareness of sextortion, because it is the fastest growing crime, cybercrime against young people. There have been something like 27 suicides in the last 2 years, and that's in the US alone. We know, of course, there's two others in the UK recently as well. And the case has been watched by people all over the world, and particularly, of course, people in Nigeria, and they've been trying to make sure that the Nigerian Yahoo boys, as they call them, they're this sort of culture of people using cybercrime to earn a living. They've been trying to get the story out that this can happen. People are killing themselves because of your activity and your actions.
That was Joe Tennedy. You're listening to the newsroom from the BBC World Service. Still to come.
At the very least, we should be able to represent our constituents around the world in our own countries by telling them.
practice of allowing children to be adopted overseas. Now, the Democratic Republic of Congo is the epicenter of the most serious outbreak of mpox. It's a viral disease similar to smallpox, and it causes, amongst other things, a terrible body rash that can be deadly. Tens of thousands of people have caught it, 600 of them or so have died. People around the world are very worried because it's spreading fast, and the World Health Organization has declared it a global emergency. And today marks a big day in the fight back. The first of nearly 100,000 doses of the mpox vaccine are being administered. The eastern part of Congo is worst hit by the virus, as I've been hearing from our correspondent Simi Jolosa in the town of Goma.
Mpox is still spreading rapidly, especially this new strain, K1B, and it's spreading amongst people who live in rural areas just outside the main towns and cities of this eastern region of the country, and especially in camps for internally displaced people. That's because there's a lot of overcrowding. 70% of patients in a couple of the centers that we've visited are children, and that's because children can't help but be children.
In 1,000 feet, turn left onto Pennsylvania 104 South, South 10th Street.
Who have told us they are waiting for the vaccines. They're eager for it because they've seen what mpox can do. They've seen the pain and suffering it causes. We spoke to one woman, Faraha, whose three children had mpox, and they're just hoping the vaccines will get here.
Take the next left onto Pennsylvania 104 South, South 10th Street.
Administering this vaccine when it does arrive in that part of the DRC.
There are a number of unique challenges that authorities...
Continue on Pennsylvania 104 South for 9 miles.
...and administering the vaccines, the main one being the ongoing armed conflict in this area. It's between the Congolese army and several rebel groups, most notably the M23 rebel groups, who are not too far from where I am now in Goma. They're around 20 to 30 kilometers away from here. And I've spoken to the governor of North Kivu, which is a region which Goma is in, who has expressed concern over how the armed conflict will affect the deployment of the vaccines here. Authorities will look at potentially increasing security for the ground transport. They may also consider using helicopters as well.
Are people in that part of the country generally keen to take the vaccines when they are actually available?
Yes. In the IDP camps, definitely. We've spoken to a couple of people who said they are keen to get the vaccines and to take them. We have spoken to one man who has had mpox, and he says he's had it, he's done with it, he's okay. But here in Goma, within the actual city, people aren't as concerned. There isn't a lot of social distancing going on, and that's because the outbreak isn't really affecting the cities and towns. But we haven't encountered a lot of vaccine hesitancy. On the contrary, we've heard people say that they want not only vaccines, but more supplies, hygiene supplies, medical supplies, because doctors have told us in one hospital in Kavulu, which is in South Kivu, that they're running out. They're running out of testing kits, of treatments as well, which would be like antibiotics and topical creams, and they need the government to increase these supplies.
It is very difficult, but not impossible, to report from most of the conflicts going on in the world, places like Sudan and Ukraine. But in Gaza, journalists have been even less successful in reporting what's going on. Because over the last year, they have repeatedly been denied access by the Israeli government. Michelle Hussein has been speaking to CNN's chief intellectual presenter, Christiane Amanpour, who's currently reporting from Ukraine.
In my experience, it's not just unusual, it's unprecedented for a country that calls itself the leading democracy in that region. Here in Dnipro, and in Kyiv, and in Kharkiv, and all the places that I've been over this last week, we have a lot more access, and this country has been a democracy for far longer than Israel has. And it's very interesting to be able to see the difference in what we're able to tell because of the access that we're able to get. We have tried so many times
Israeli government not long ago about these restrictions. He said this is a war zone. We're trying to get our hostages out, and we will do nothing whatsoever to jeopardize the safety of our hostages. If journalists are there, that makes the situation even more complicated.
Well, I'm not sure what he's talking about, frankly. Ever since time immemorial, journalists have been covering wars. We understand what it takes. We understand various rules of engagement, and we understand how to operate in these areas. To your point about Gaza journalists, that is the absolute tragedy, that because they are journalists inside Gaza, because they are, for the most part, Gazans, Palestinians, then Israel and its allies have been able to cast aspersions on what they report. And that is incredibly unfair, incredibly, you know, wrong. It is not a solution. We are journalists who represent democracies around the world, not these journalists who represent key allies of Israel, without whom it would not have the economic or military might that it has. And at the very least, we should be able to represent our constituents around the world in our own countries by telling them what is going on and how an ally is conducting itself in a war zone. There's no excuse for this whatsoever. I mean, here we are in Ukraine, there are ballistic missiles being thrown around here at random and at will. We're still covering it. There are cruise missiles. There's F-16s bombing us. I mean, hello?
That's Christiane Anopra. People are bracing themselves in southern China and Vietnam for super typhoon Yagi. At the moment, it's hitting the island of Hainan. 500,000 people have been evacuated to safe ground ahead of that. And it looks like it's going to be the strongest storm there for over a decade. At least 30 people were killed in flooding and landslides as Yagi swept through the Philippines. Laura Bigger is our correspondent in Beijing.
It's doubled in strength after it wreaked havoc in the northern Philippines. Meteorologists are telling us it's got winds of up to around 240 kilometers an hour. But I think what we're looking at is the island of Hainan. Now, this is like a popular tourist spot in China. It's got beautiful sandy beaches, lovely coastlines, but obviously that would make it quite vulnerable to typhoons. The sweeping round of the island, winds that are sweeping round the eye, are also scheduled to hit Guangdong. Now, the important thing about Guangdong is it's once was known as the factory of the world. It's China's manufacturing hub, and it's already suffered from a number of floods this year. China has dispatched a task force right across southern China to prepare for floods and to prepare for any potential typhoon-related damage.
An extraordinary coincidence today. We've heard from China's weather service that last month was the country's hottest August in more than six decades. The EU is saying that the past 3 months, the hottest June and August ever recorded. These changes in weather patterns mean that China, particularly, and those other countries in that area, are going to have to think long and hard about where to build things in the future. Are there plans for relocating things, do you think?
China is one of the most vulnerable countries in the world. It suffers from a real water crisis. First of all, during the monsoon season, it has too much water and it all falls in the same place and at the same time. And then, of course, it has huge dry seasons, massive droughts. So it has this problem between drought and between flood. Meanwhile, it has a country that is thirsty for water. It doesn't have enough water in long term to supply most of its population. And this is something that it's having to grapple with. Not that you just heard the figures there. The annual kind of climate blue book that you're referring to is released by the China Meteorological Administration. It's warning that temperatures across the country could rise by 1.7 to 2.8 degrees Celsius within the next 30 years. And it's eastern China, so it's those coastal areas and that northwest region of Xinjiang, which suffers from drought, will suffer the most.
Now, let's end this program with sneezes. They can be loud, often come with threes, and sometimes it seems they can be bad for your health, as one professional footballer can attest to. Nigerian Victor Adebayo, who plays for an English team called Bolton Wanderers, missed a game midweek after suffering an unusual injury caused by what's been described as a hefty sneeze. Club manager Ian Everett says results after he felt a crack in between his ribs. We told reporters Victor is a powerful boy, even his sneezes are powerful. So how dangerous can they be? Rick Edwards has been speaking to Adam Taylor.
Blue news for the more bizarre injuries we've come across in recent seasons. You know, as everybody knows, sneezing is just one of those things that happens every day. But there are risks that are associated with this bodily function.
So, is it more risky the sort of more powerful you are, as his manager sort of suggests there?
It's entirely possible. I mean, we don't typically see sneezing-related injuries in young athletes. You know, the demographic of people we typically see with these kind of injuries are usually elderly because they've got weaker or lower bone mass, and 80% of injuries do occur in men in and around their 40s, but typically the most severe injuries, such as broken ribs, are seen in elderly people. And so, you know, there is that element, as his manager describes, of Victor being a very strong guy, and that's, you know, we have to think about that his muscle force and the power that he's generating, even from those small muscles in and around your ribs and your chest, are probably far greater than yours or mine are. So there is that risk, you know, in people with lean body mass, high muscle percentage, that they're exerting a force that's far greater on their bony architecture than you or I could ever dream of doing.
But it is better to sneeze than not sneeze, isn't it? You want to get the stuff out. That's the point of sneezes.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. You know, the body sneezes to clear potentially dangerous material, you know, dust particles, viruses, bacteria, out of our airways and out of our passages, to protect our delicate lung tissues. And, you know, there are, as we've discussed, there are risks with sneezing, but there's also probably bigger risks with open sneezes.
Yeah, just very quickly, yes or no, is it true that if you sneeze with your eyes open, your eyes can pop out?
That's fake.
Phew, you heard it here first, good to know. With Adam Taylor speaking to Rick Edwards. And it brings this edition of the programme to a close. Thanks for listening.
This is the BBC World Service with Kavita Puri meeting the last survivors of the 1943 Bengal famine.
People had no food to eat, no clothes to wear. People died of hunger. I now always keep hooks locked up.
The impact of the famine and the trauma of it still lingers. I mean, he still keeps 2 years' worth of food because of the fear of famine is still so real and visceral to him today.
A mother was holding her baby on her breast, but she was not able to feed her as she was not producing any milk from starvation. The baby died while on her breast in the train.
The collection of the memories of the living human victims is definitely the memorial for the future.
3 million roads to the past at bbcworldservice.com/documentaries or wherever you get your BBC podcasts.
Today on the Global Story, we're looking at growing pressure on Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to negotiate a ceasefire in Gaza. Nearly a year after the 7th of October attacks, Israelis have taken to the streets and international allies are getting more vocal in their criticism. So, can anything or anyone change Benjamin Netanyahu's mind? That's after the latest world news.
In a quarter mile, turn right onto US 522 South West Market Street.
The practice of offering children for adoption abroad. At least 150,000 Chinese children have been adopted overseas in the last 3 decades. The now scrapped one-child policy often forced Chinese families to abandon their babies. Supratai Funyagi has made landfall on the Chinese holiday island of Hainan. 400,000 people were evacuated and trains, boats and flights suspended.
At the light, turn right onto US 522 South West Market Street.
After an operation that lasted almost 10 days, Palestinian officials say 21 people were killed, including civilians. The UN says both sides...
Continue on US 522 South for 20 miles.
...that might amount to war crimes and crimes against humanity. A fact-finding mission interviewed witnesses in neighboring countries, but wasn't allowed into Sudan itself. Officials in central Kenya have given more details about a fire at a school that killed at least 17 children. They say the fire broke out late at night in a dormitory where more than 150 boys were sleeping. President Zelensky has for the first time addressed a meeting of Ukraine's military backers at the U.S. Zoo base in Rammstein in Germany. Sitting next to the U.S. Secretary of Defense, Mr. Zelensky repeated his request that Ukraine supporters authorize the use of long-range missiles to attack targets within Russia. The head of NATO has criticized China for the support it's giving to Russia. Jens Stoltenberg described China as a decisive enabler behind the invasion of Ukraine by assisting Russia with its production of weapons. The EU's climate monitor Copernicus has said the Earth experienced the hottest June and August ever recorded. BBC News.
Hello, I'm Cathy Adler from the BBC World Service. This is the global story. Streets in recent days. They're calling for a ceasefire in Gaza and criticizing
demonstrators, but on the other side, and these are the people who Netanyahu is keeping very close, are the leaders of the extreme ultra-nationalist settler right in Israel. And he has a political alliance with them which delivered him a parliamentary majority. And the leaders of those groups are two gentlemen, they're both cabinet ministers, Itamar Ben-Gvir and Bezalel Smotrich. Ben-Gvir wrote on X regarding the current negotiations about a ceasefire, because of course those hostages were found dead, killed by Hamas in Gaza. That's the Israeli judgment on what happened. A country that has, Ben-Gvir wrote on X, a country that has six of its hostages murdered in cold blood, doesn't hold negotiations with the murderers, but it stops the negotiations, stops giving them fuel and electricity, crushes them until they're defeated. So while there are people on the streets, what matters to Netanyahu is that there are people in the government who continue to support him and keep him in office, and Ben-Gvir and his associate and sometime rival, Smotrich, have both said that if he goes down the road of making deals that they believe are surrender, they will topple his government. And Netanyahu is clear wants to stay in power.
Of course, so to summarize, he has political pressure from the extreme right in Israeli politics, so he prefers to listen to them than the people on the street. But how divided are the people of Israel, Jeremy? Could it get to a point where those angry with Netanyahu, demanding a change in his military policy right now in Gaza, at least for a temporary ceasefire to get the hostages out, they could topple him as well?
Well, they can only topple him with parliamentary support, and the Israeli parliament, the Knesset, is actually on a extended summer recess till just about a week before the US elections. There are signs that Netanyahu is trying to just keep things going until the US elections, when I think, of course, it'll be happy that Donald Trump wins, and Donald Trump was very frantic to him in his last administration.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to have Prime Minister Netanyahu, a great friend of mine, and a great friend of the country. We have a tremendous relationship.
There's a fresh episode
episode available as a podcast each weekday. Just search for The Global Story wherever you get your podcasts. With me is the BBC's international editor, Jeremy Bowen. What about the international pressure? Because allies of Israel are clearly disturbed by the death toll in Gaza, you know, 41,000 and more increasing. So on Monday we heard US President Joe Biden saying he didn't think that Mr. Netanyahu was doing enough to reach a deal.
Mr. President, do you think it's time for Prime Minister Netanyahu to do more on this issue? Do you think he's doing enough?
No.
And Kamala Harris, since becoming the Democratic presidential nominee, has told Mr. Netanyahu it is time to end the conflict.
I also expressed with the Prime Minister my serious concern about the scale of the human suffering in Gaza, including the death of far too many innocent civilians. How, at the end of this day, is the U.S. with all this? Does it have a temper when it comes to Israel?
I think he's regretful and probably resentful about the way that
quarter mile, slight left onto Back Maitland Road. Left onto Back Maitland Road.
You can also listen as a podcast. Just search for The Global Story wherever you get your BBC pods. And if you want to get in touch, you can email
continue for 11 miles.
BBC.com. Wherever you're listening in the world. Goodbye. This is the BBC World Service, exploring the arts, culture, and music from around the world.
I'm creating work with natural materials like driftwood or sand. My studio is the beach.
I like writing about creepy people and weird people and strange families and odd houses. Performing live when it's in the right environment. Something that I can really kind of lose myself in, and I love that.
Arts, music, and culture from the BBC World Service. In 60 Minutes, the newsroom.
We're live at the site of a primary school fire in Kenya in which 17 boys were killed. We find out why China is ending the practice of allowing children to be adopted overseas. And don't hold me in, we hear about a professional footballer who ignored that advice and ended up in the sick bay.
This is the BBC World Service, the world's radio station. It's the Outlook Mixtape with me, Indy Rickerson. We'll be cheering from the sidelines as people strive to achieve their lifelong dreams. For Diana Nyad, that means swimming 110 miles from Cuba to the USA.
I started that little tickle on the back of the imagination that my mom had planted about Cuba's right over there. As a matter of fact, it's so close. You little champion swimmer there, you could actually swim there.
Edward Jr. had always dreamed of going into space, something his mum prepared him for from an early age.
Every night she'd walk into my little notebook and pick my hand and tell me that I was the greatest thing and that she loved me to death and that I could do anything in the world as long as I prepared for it.
A decade-long ambition becomes a world record reality in the Outlook Mixtape right after the latest BBC News headlines.
BBC News with Sue Montgomery. China says it's ending overseas adoptions, a practice that's seen more than 150,000 children sent abroad in the last 3 decades. It's unclear what will happen to applications currently being processed. A number of countries have expressed concern about international adoptions. China said it was adapting to these changing attitudes, and officials have been encouraging couples to have more children. Here's Mickey Bristow.
There has been a real shift in the attitude towards a number of children in China by the Chinese government. About a decade ago, China ended the one-child policy, which had led to, if I put it insensitively, an excess of children. Parents were punished if they had more than one child, and so a lot of families were simply forced to put their children up for adoption or put them into orphanages. So that created a market, if you will, for overseas adoption. The Chinese government allowed it simply as a way to allow these children to find loving families.
Super Typhoon Yagi has made landfall in the popular Chinese holiday island of Hainan. State media say 400,000 people have been evacuated from their homes. Israeli forces have pulled out of Jenin in the occupied West Bank after a major operation lasting almost 10 days. The first Palestinians to leave their homes say there's extensive damage. Funerals are taking place amid the rubble. James Landale reports.
The city was the
says an independent and impartial force should be deployed to Sudan as the civil war continues to have a devastating impact on civilians. A fact-finding mission spoke to witnesses in Chad, Kenya and Uganda, but wasn't allowed into Sudan itself. The conflict between the Sudanese army and the paramilitary rapid support forces began in April last year. Munir Rushmani, part of the UN mission, said both sides had carried out atrocities.
We found that there are reasonable grounds to believe that both SAF and RSF and their respective allies have committed the war crimes of violence against life and person, in particular murder of all kinds, mutilation, cruel treatment and torture, and committing outrages upon personal dignity, in particular humiliation and degrading treatment.
BBC News. President Zelensky has for the first time addressed a meeting of Ukraine's military backers at the US air base in Ramstein in Germany. Mr. Zelensky repeated his request for allies to let Kyiv use long-range missiles to attack targets within Russia. Prosecutors in Poland have issued arrest warrants for three Belarusian citizens believed to be responsible for forcing down an airliner in 2021. The flight from Greece to Lithuania had an opposition journalist among its passengers, and when it passed over Belarusian territory, the pilot was told to land, as there were explosives on board. None were found, but Roman Protasiewicz was arrested. A rebel group in Myanmar says at least 11 civilians were killed in a town that it controls during an attack by government aircraft. The bombing took place in Namkam in northern Shan State, near the border with China. There's been fierce fighting in the state over recent months, with an alliance of rebel groups taking territory from the military-run central government. Officials in Paris say they will name a sports venue after the event in Olympic runner Rebecca Cheptegei, who died earlier this week after a former boyfriend allegedly doused her in petrol and set her on fire. Here's Camilla Mills.
The mayor of Paris, Anne Hidalgo, said Rebecca Cheptegei dazzled at the Olympics and that the city will not forget her. Cheptegei succumbed to severe burns on Thursday after being attacked in front of her two young children at her home in Kenya. She had made her Olympic debut in the women's marathon at the Paris Games, where she finished 44th. The Kenyan government said the tragedy was a stark reminder that more needed to be done to combat gender-based violence. Rights groups say at least 500 women have been killed in acts of femicide since 2016 in Kenya.
BBC News.
Hello, and welcome to the Outlook Mixtape. I'm India Rackerson, and today I'm bringing you a selection of stories unearthed by the Outlook team. Because every week in the mixtape, we get to dive back into all the programs of the past week and cherry pick some of the highlights. And this week's selection are all tales of great determination.
In a quarter mile, turn right onto Kishakakia Street. Take the next right onto Kishakakia Street, then turn left onto East Charles Street.
It's a local problem that we can't help you. So my mother that wrote the Pope himself, she wrote the Vatican.
And she wrote to the Pope?
Yes.
Wow.
And the Vatican ordered that school to integrate. And that's how I ended up, my sister and I integrated.
At the light, turn left onto East Charles Street.
Back in 1947. I think I was just back there last week, where they got a big portrait of me. They got, as you enter the school, they got my books, my memorabilia, and everything else.
And the time it has to be persuaded.
Yes, yes, yes.
See, Ed was getting great grades. They're just growing, growing. He got a scholarship to study art. And for a while, it could have been a couple of years ago. But then something changed, and then he was out of his way.
In a quarter mile, merge onto US 22, Business West.
Kansas City, my hometown. And it was sharp, like me. And I says, oh my God, they're letting blacks fly airplanes.
So Ed scouted out the recruitment office and enrolled in the Air Force. He became a skilled test pilot and he loved his job. And then one day, he got a letter inviting him to train to become an astronaut, the first African-American astronaut. Who is this letter from?
It was from the Pentagon. That's the direction of the president.
At the direction of the president, John F. Kennedy.
Yeah. And so I get this letter, and I just responded to it.
In 1,000 feet, turn left onto Pennsylvania 103 South.
...to a white man's club, and he didn't think that he'd be welcome there. But his mother, well, she told him he should do it for the sake of all African-Americans. So warily, he accepted and began the training.
At the light, turn left onto Pennsylvania 103 South.
But the bullet that had killed John F. Kennedy also destroyed Ed's dream of going into space. Without JFK's...
In a quarter mile, turn right onto Helen Street.
And he was sent to Germany. Eventually, he left the Air Force altogether. He began instead to refocus on his art, and he became a really successful painter and sculptor, creating detailed figures, faces, and exploring black history and culture. Space travel was always there. Until earlier this year, at the age of 90, Ed broke a world record and became the oldest person in space. He was invited to be a passenger on a rocket.
Take the second right onto Helen Street.
Short flight to the edge of space and back. And it meant the world to Ed.
In 800 feet, you will arrive at your destination. You have arrived.
Was it worth the wait?
Oh, hell yes. Oh, God, yes. Yes, yes, yes. I wouldn't have had any other way.
Ed Dwight finally living out his childhood dream and talking there to Joe Fidgen. And our next guest is not dissimilar to Ed. There's bucket loads of perseverance in her story, a fiery will to push boundaries and take on danger.